So thank you to everyone for being here. I'm really excited. I think this is going to be a fun event. If you don't know me, my name is Caitlin Pena. I'm the Director of Operations and Programs here for the Center for Election Science. In case you are new to the Center for Election Science, we are a nonpartisan nonprofit, and we are dedicated to empowering voters with a better way to vote. So what we mainly advocate for is called approval voting. And approval voting is super simple. It just allows you to vote for as many candidates as you like, and then the candidate with the most votes wins. And so I'm sure we'll talk a little bit more about approval voting today. Michael will probably discuss some about approval voting and how it can interact with the environmental movement and be a boon for reform. So without further ado, I will go ahead and introduce our guests. So we have Christine Morshedi here. She's going to be our interviewer. Christine earned her PhD in applied mathematics and worked for 30 years in the area of seismic data processing and depth imaging for ExxonMobil. Now she's retired, and she volunteers as the group leader for the San Diego County North Inland Chapter of the Citizens Climate Lobby, and she also volunteers for us at the Center for Election Science. And then we've also got Michael Ruvinsky. Christine will be interviewing Michael. He is the vice chair of the Center for Election Science Board of Directors. He's also an actor and a former software engineer. And alongside voting method reform, Michael is active in and passionate about the environmental movement. So I will go ahead and hand it off to you all. If anybody has questions, feel free to type them in the chat. And towards the end of the event, we'll have a Q&A session. I'll go through and pick out your questions for Christine and Michael to answer. If you'd rather be able to actually ask your question out loud, you can click on the participants button at the bottom of the screen, and then there's a raise hand feature. So click on that, and then I will unmute you. That way you can ask your question. And if you can't find the raise hand feature, just type in the chat, say, I want to ask a question. I'll unmute you that way. So take it away, Christine.
Oh, thank you. Well, Caitlin, you already answered my first question, but I'm going to ask Michael anyway, because I thought it would be an easy way to start. Michael, tell us again, what is approval voting?
Hi, everybody. Hi, Christine. Good to be here. So approval voting is, as Caitlin said, it's very simple. I can give you a little bit of background, just really briefly, on the Center for Election Science. It was founded about 10 years ago by a bunch of election science nerds who recognized, as many of us do, that the voting system that we use is highly problematic. We tend to have spoilers. It tends to not really measure what people want very well. It doesn't work when there's more than two candidates, so it tends to only offer us two choices. And they went in agnostic as to what kind of voting method would be best to replace it with, and they looked at everything, and they came up with a clear winner, which was approval voting. Approval voting is one of the best voting methods out there as far as allowing voters to say what they want to say, measuring what voters actually want. And it is also hands down the easiest to implement, in that it is basically almost exactly the same as the voting method we have now. It just, there's one tiny tweak, but basically you don't have to change the hardware. You don't have to change the ballot. You could implement it tomorrow without any real cost. A city could, a state could, a country could. And the way it works is, so currently now, our current voting method, which is empirically, according to the voting nerds, it is empirically the worst possible voting method out there. Approval voting is at the other end of the scale. It's one of the best. The way it works now is you have a list of candidates. Candidates have check boxes next to their names. You check one of the boxes, and you add up all the checked boxes, and the candidate who has the most checked boxes wins. Approval voting is exactly the same thing, except that you take away the restriction that you're only allowed to support one candidate. So now a voter sees the same list of candidates, sees the check boxes, can check one box, can check two boxes, can check three boxes, depending on how many candidates there are. You can check as many boxes as you want, and then everything else is the same. You add up all the votes, you add up all the checked boxes, the candidate with the most votes wins. And this is a very, very tiny change that has huge ramifications, just amazing, amazing. It's like spending a dollar and getting a house. It's an incredible improvement for a very small change. So that's what approval voting is.
Okay, thanks.
You think I covered that? You think I covered the important points?
That was great. I think we can go home now. That was it.
Okay, great.
But my next question is going to be for myself. So we're talking about approval voting and environmental causes. So my question for myself, I won't do this throughout, but is who is an environmentalist? And I've seen Catherine Hayhoe speak on this. She's a climate scientist from Texas Tech University, and she's an excellent speaker. She's also a person of faith who's very strongly Christian and feels that that's a part of herself. And she said she Googled environmentalist, and the first, whatever, 8 pictures that came up were basically almost all men, almost all dead. 5 of them had a big beard. And she said, this is just not the right answer. So she talked for a while and came up with the fact that an environmentalist is a human being who lives on planet Earth. And I think that's really important to understand. I mean, if you go up to anybody in the street and you say, do you want clean air to breathe? And they'll say, yes. Do you want clean water to drink? And they'll say, yes. Do you want to not have the danger of a wildfire or a flood in your community? And they will say, yes. The difference is some people will say, yes, but I don't want to ruin the economy, or yes, but blah, 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 some other reason that they don't want to do anything about it. And then other people will say, yes, and we need to put a climate tax. We need to use cap and trade. We need to put regulations. We need to stop doing this or start doing that. So there's a wide variety of answers, but there isn't anyone who doesn't care about the environment. And I think that's a very important thing to think about. And it leads into my biggest question for Michael, which is, considering that everyone cares about the environment and it's a really top priority, well, maybe they don't think it's a top priority, but I think it should be a top priority. Why hasn't our government acted aggressively to tackle, you know, to keep the environment safe and to tackle climate change?
Excellent question. I can guess is what I can do. And I should probably do just a bit of a disclaimer here and say that, so I'm on the board of the directors of the Center for Election Science. I'm not a spokesperson for the organization. I don't speak for the organization. Also, we are a nonpartisan nonprofit. And what that means to me is that we advocate for better systems, better democracy that allows more ideas to get out there, allows people to say how they feel about those ideas, actually measures this, you know, how much support those ideas have or don't have. And so we're a nonpartisan organization. We don't take a particular political position unless making the world better for everybody through having a better democracy is a political position. That said, I firmly believe, as I'm sure a lot of people do here on this call, that as a species, personally, I believe, as a species, we have an obligation to protect the planet and not destroy it. And I believe we are failing in that obligation. And so I'm excited to answer your question and talk about what having a better voting method might, how that might help us to make the planet a better place for all the creatures that live on it, including our grandchildren and their grandchildren and their grandchildren. So would you repeat your question, please?
Why hasn't the government acted decisively to tackle climate change?
Yes, exactly. Why haven't they, right? So we have that's the thing, right? We have something that is pretty clearly something that most people would support, which is not destroying the planet. And I'm sure you have better, CCL probably has better metrics of that, but the majority of Americans want our government to do a lot more than it's doing on climate change, I believe is a fair thing to say. So we have people, the voters who want something, the majority of whom want something, they elect representatives to represent them. Those representatives aren't doing that thing. Why? I would argue that it's not necessarily that the representatives aren't responsive to the voters, is that they're much more responsive to other things. They are No, I would argue that it's not that they aren't responsive to the voters, and they are instead responsive to, say, large multinational corporations. And there's been lots of research on this that shows that the desires of large multinational corporations and the desires of really wealthy individuals tend to align with what legislators do, and the desires of everybody else pretty much doesn't. Why is that? Why is it that our representatives aren't responsive to us? Why do we need to write letters to the editor? Why do we need to? So CCL, you have 100,000 or more members constantly advocating for better legislative solutions to climate change and going to Washington and lobbying every single member of Congress. And still they don't do it. Yeah, I mean, it's a really good question. And I would put it down to the voting method. I think that as we talk about the voting method, we can see that using something like approval voting would really, really change the dynamic, and that it would get more voices in there and more competition for the two parties who, while they talk a very different game about the climate, neither party seems to really actually be willing to do it. I mean, you still have to go lobby the Democrats, and the difference is that when you lobby the Democrats, instead of them saying, oh no, climate change isn't real, they say, oh yeah, climate change is real and we wish we could do something about it. I mean, it's, sorry.
Well, I think it is changing. I think we're moving, but we're moving very slowly. And I also think the reason it's changing is Mother Nature, maybe not the voters. But I want to help you out too. I want to talk about, I made a list for myself of characteristics of climate change that make this a difficult issue to tackle with the government. And I think the reason I want to say this is that it's not just the environment and climate change that we aren't, our government isn't addressing, even though there's a hot, large majority that care about it. So one thing about climate change, it's so complex. It covers everything. It has to do with the food we eat and the water we need and our housing supplies and forests and oceans and just our comfort and the beauty of the planet. So it's very complex. So it's sort of dispersed, our interests are dispersed in that. It has fallen into very strangely this culture war or partisan divide. And I don't understand that at all. And I think a little later we're going to talk about sort of the political landscape, but I don't want to go into that too much right now. But there seems to be this right versus left. And when an issue falls that it's on one side or the other, suddenly the people on the other can't talk about it and can't agree on it, and they have to be against it. So I think a lot of what approval voting might change is people being for something instead of being against something all the time. But the other thing is it's a very long-term issue, at least we think so, or we did think so, far away in space, affecting other people, which isn't probably true, but that's what we think, and coming in the future much farther than our election cycle, although that's not as true as it used to be either. The other thing is that it's hard to make this the top voting priority for the majority of people. And we'll talk about that again later too. So I just sort of want to get those things out there, because any other issue that has some of those characteristics is going to have the same problems that climate change has had with the government reaction.
Have this idea that there's two sides, which is something, an idea that really, really bothers me, that people talk about there's always two sides to everything. No, there's way more than two sides to everything. And there's way more than, and when you sort of narrow your existence down to two political parties, and the only thing that matters is how they differ, you lose track of how they're the same and what else could be out there and what other ways there could be of doing things.
Yeah, the search for common ground is really narrowed. The other thing about climate change that a lot of people don't think about is that there's no clear villain, or at least we don't want there to be a clear villain, because it would be us. And so that makes it hard to attack it. Anyway, just wanted to throw that out there too.
How does a cancer that is destroying the body stop itself? How do we as individuals, how do we all work together to change what we are and what we're doing?
It's pretty hard for people to tackle something that they feel a little bit responsible for, but they'd rather blame somebody else.
There's a big narrative that it's all about personal responsibility, and I think that's a narrative that's pushed by the people that don't want the government to do something about it. I do strongly feel that the most efficient way for us to decide what is ethical and to behave ethically and to create the structures that support being ethical is through the government. I mean, I think we do need, I don't think climate change is going to be solved by everyone deciding individually whether or not they're going to be ethical and how they're going to do that. We do have to, there are ways that we have to work together, and therefore we need the government to legislate as it does for ethics. I mean, the government comes in and says, you can't kill somebody. That's wrong. We don't leave it up to individuals to decide whether or not they're going to kill people or how much, you know, or just maim them, or, you know, it's wrong. We create a rule that says you can't kill people, and we create, and as far as the environment goes, if we're going to create systems where we can all live on this planet without destroying it, we're going to have to somehow share the burden of working together and making the sacrifices that are necessary in an equitable way. And that just can't be done by just people just deciding individually how much they're willing or able to do. Because, I mean, I can decide, I mean, I'm sure everyone has this problem. I mean, you want to live an ethical life, but you also have to eat. And I go to the grocery store, I don't know what, every bite of food that I eat is contributing in some way to making the world a worse place, because there's no structure in place that helps me to, or that encourages or requires an ethical way of producing food that is sustainable.
That's true. And we agree on these things, and we're getting, this is fun, but let's get to the...
We're getting off topic, off the voting method topic.
Let's get to details. I decided we should talk about what I think are the four steps of an election cycle. Well, there's a lot, but there is the campaigning and the debating. There is the actual vote. A voter expresses their preference. There is the result of the vote, and there's the analysis of what happened during that election cycle. I think that with plurality voting, the only thing we look at is the result. And I think approval voting has a big advantage in some of the other portions. So I was thinking we could talk especially about, maybe as Kate, as examples, the Democratic primary and the Republican primary in 2016, and then the Democratic primary and for the 2020 election, and see if we can find some examples that would really help us understand how approval voting could make a change.
Yeah.
So
great.
Let's talk about the campaign and the debating first. And I wanted to ask you if you remember any discussion of climate change in 2016.
No, my sense of things is that it's always an issue that people are always pushing for and saying, people, they should be talking about this more. They should be talking about this more, but they don't tend to.
Yeah. And then in 2020, we had one candidate who stepped up and said climate change in the Democratic side and said, climate change, that's all, that is the main part of my candidacy. And let's talk a little about what happened to him, Jay Inslee.
Okay.
So, and how that would have been different if we had approval voting in the primaries.
So what you're saying is Jay Inslee, and I will say that for the Democratic primary, oh. I'm sorry, I don't want to get too sidetracked. No. Tell me about Jay Inslee. Okay.
So he was a candidate who pretty much said, there's one issue that's important, and that's climate change. And
right.
I'm running for president to tackle climate change.
Right.
But he didn't get very far.
Okay.
And we don't know how much support he had.
We don't know how much support he had. I mean, no. we know how many people voted for him, which is probably about zero. But we don't know how much support he had or how many people would have liked to have voted for him.
Yeah.
So my experience with the Democratic primary, so this is relevant, is there were 20 candidates, and I have enough fury in my life and frustration that I could not bring myself to research these candidates, because I knew that it was going to come down to on primary night, if I were voting in the Democratic primary in California, is it's going to come down to a choice between who are the two front runners. And it's probably going to be Joe Biden, who represents more the one wing of the Democratic Party. And it's either going to be Sanders or Warren, who represents sort of another wing of the Democratic Party. And it really comes down to a question of which wing are you going to vote for? whether I've gotten excited about anybody else, Jay Inslee or Andrew Yang or anybody else, is irrelevant. So it was very much a disincentive for me to even research people, because I was just going to get my hopes up for something that I couldn't express a preference for. So if you vote for Jay Inslee because you want to support the environment, you're basically saying you don't care whether it's Biden or Sanders, basically, which is what it came down to in California.
Yeah, that's right. And also, it's very time consuming to look into all of those different people if you aren't going to be able to express a preference for those, for any of them, because, you know, again, you want your vote to count, not whether it shows what you really want, but you want your vote to be for a person who could win.
Right. So let's talk about this is one of the clear differences between approval voting and plurality voting. With plurality voting, you have a single vote and you can give it to one person. And that's how it works. And if you're going to give it to one person, you can't give it to somebody else. And if somebody wants to get your vote, they can. They don't necessarily need to convince you to like them. They just need to convince you to dislike the other person. And it results in a lot of negative campaigning. With approval voting, it's a very simple change, but it's a totally conceptually different thing, which is that instead of having one vote to give to one candidate, you are now, as a voter, you get to look at each candidate independently and say thumbs up or thumbs down. So if you want to say, I support the environment, you can vote for Jay Inslee, even if you don't think he's going to win, because that doesn't prevent you from also making a choice in between Warren Sanders, Biden, or whoever the front runners are.
Right. And sorry if I cut you off.
No, go ahead.
What you said about you're not deciding who you like, or they're not trying to convince you to like them. The candidates are trying to convince you not to like the others. And I think this negative campaigning that we have with plurality voting is really bad during the campaigns and the debates. And I think it keeps us from investigating a lot of facets of an issue that's important, like the hidden costs of pollution or environmental justice part of climate change. Because a candidate might say, oh, I want to tackle climate change, but they don't go much further because they don't need to, because they don't want you, they don't want to help somebody else who's really going further than they are in climate change. Can you address that?
Yeah, so without getting into like specific examples, just with like hypothetical examples, say you have two candidates who are running who are very similar. Under our current voting system, there's gonna be a huge, those two candidates are both hurting each other by being in the race, right?
Exactly.
Because they're splitting that vote. If you have people that support both of those candidates, those people can't actually support both of those candidates. They have to pick one. So therefore the support for that is getting split in half. So if those candidates want to win and want to get more votes, the best place to get votes is from the people who are voting for the other one. And the way you get votes is to convince it. So it causes this huge divide where if I'm similar to someone, I'm just furious that they're in the race because they're hurting my chances. And they're likewise furious that I'm in the race because I'm hurting their chances. And so we hate each other and we tear each other apart and we talk about, you know, we try and find any way to tear each other down to convince our people to vote for just one of us. Whereas if voters were allowed to look at each candidate independently and say, I like you, I like you, I don't like you, I don't like you, I like you, that candidate that I am similar to, I don't need to go to that person's voters and say, don't vote for them, they're bad, but you vote for me instead. I go to their voters and say, they're great. I love them. I'm just like, I support everything they support. You can vote for me too. It's a totally different, potentially, a totally different way of campaigning, because what you're looking for is broad support. You're not looking to divide and conquer.
The other example, the Republican primaries of 2016.
Sure, let's go there.
A lot of candidates and Trump. And all he had to do was be different and get them to attack each other. Because people had to choose between Jeb Bush and Marco Rubio and Ted Cruz, and they might have been very similar in so many ways, but they had to choose between them. But Trump was so different, he could have just had a very minority of support, but everybody else was split.
And he did in most early on, I think, and in all previous attempts to run for president. Trump is the only Trump. Whereas there were lots of 17 candidates in that primary. 17, you know, there were a lot of them that were probably could be lumped together as regular mainstream Republicans.
And instead of supporting each other, they were attacking each other.
Right.
They had to. And Caitlin.
And the thing is, if it had just been between Trump and Jeb Bush, I don't think there's any question that Jeb Bush would have wiped the floor with Trump. I mean, any of them would have, probably. But somehow he leveraged the situation by getting enough support early on, because all the other support was split between all the other non-Trump people, that he managed to, you know, then people start dropping out because they don't have enough support. And then he gets this.
Yeah,
I am certain that he would not have won, that Trump would not have won the Republican primary if we had had a better voting method.
Yeah, I wanted, Caitlin, there are people with raised hands. Do you want to let them ask questions now, or are you going to wait?
I was going to wait until the end. That way you could get through most of your questions. But if you prefer, I can go ahead and let Emily ask her question.
Okay, it's fine with me.
All right, just a second, Emily. Let me get you unmuted. There you go.
Hi. So I just wanted to jump in to mention that Congress is responsive to the public, but we haven't been participating at the degree that we would need to. Republican offices say they need 100 phone calls from constituents on climate change to make that a top priority for them. And we are not near that for the 2/3 of districts that we would need. So we still have a lot of work to do, but it would probably be true that we would need fewer than 100 if we were using approval voting, because a majority of Republican voters support action on climate, and it's just the far right that doesn't. But the far right is more likely to vote in primaries. And first past the post tends to elect more partisan candidates. So the far right is more rewarded under this system. So if we were using approval voting, Trump would not have won the Republican primary. And we probably would have had Rubio, from what I saw. So, and he used to be in favor of cap and trade. So I think that's his proclivity. Anyway, I think if either of the main parties used approval voting, we would be in a better situation. Or if we used it in general elections, we would definitely be in a much better position. But we either have to pass approval voting, or we need way more volunteers actively calling about climate change and voting on climate change.
I absolutely agree with you that approval voting is something that would change things for the better. I do want to challenge a little bit. I mean, I think that, I mean, yes, there, we could be doing more, we could be calling more. But my question is, why do we have to be calling at all? We elect people, we all have jobs, we have children, we have, you know, we elect people to make decisions in the best interest of the voters. And it just frustrates me how much effort people already put into trying to get their representatives to do what they ought to do, and they still don't do it. So, I mean,
Yeah. I think we would still want to communicate our priorities to lawmakers, because that's another tool in our toolbox, and corporations are going to be doing that whether we do it or not.
True.
So we do have to communicate to some extent, but it shouldn't be this difficult to pass something that 70% of the public supports.
Okay. I agree.
So many things. We've been mixing up a little bit the campaigning and debating part and the actual vote. There's one other part of the vote. Well, two other things I want to mention about the voting itself. And one is why I first started looking at approval voting a long time ago. And that was because I was generally wanting to vote for a minority candidate, but that would be a spoiler vote. And it was a very hard decision. Should you vote for a third party candidate that you really, really like, or the one who's closest to them? And if you vote for the one you really like, you're hurting the one who's closest to what you really want. And that is so strange. So that's another part about the vote. There's another thing about, for approval voting, Steve challenged me on what is the negative of it. And we talked about that a little bit. But what I forgot to tell him the other day was that it is true with approval voting, you don't get to express your full preference. You don't get to say, I like this person a lot better than that person and a little better than that person. To me, that isn't, I mean, it is true. I'd like to express my preference more, but I don't think most people care or have studied enough. And I think after everybody votes, that probably doesn't matter much. And you're giving up a lot of simplicity. So what do you think about that, Michael?
Yeah, that's a great point. I mean, one of the few, I would say few legitimate criticisms of approval voting is that it's too simple. You don't get to, so for something like range voting, which is also a really, really good evaluative system where you get to look at each candidate independently, and instead of being thumbs up, thumbs down, you give them like on a scale of 1 to 5 or 1 to 10 or something. So that gives you more flexibility to say what you want to say. On the other hand, there are a lot of advantages to me that I think with approval voting in that it creates a very clear measure of how much support candidates have. It's just how many people said thumbs up. And also, as far as the flexibility to express what you want to express, I think you still have that with approval voting. Because to just have like create a really simple example, say there's 4 candidates running and you love one, you like one, you dislike one, and you hate one. And your job is put them into 2 buckets, yes and no. As a voter, I get to decide what's most important to me. So if the most important thing to me is to give the candidate I love the best chance of winning, I can just vote for that candidate and not the other 3. That's a legitimate thing for me to do. Or if I want to say, well, what's most important to me is end up with somebody that I'm at least okay with. So let's vote for the top 2. Let's vote for the one I like and the one I love and not for the other 2. Or there could be a candidate running, that candidate that I hate, who is a threat to the world and democracy. And the most important thing is to prevent that candidate from ever being anywhere near the White House. Just hypothetical situation. In which case, I'm going to vote for everybody else. That is a huge amount of flexibility. And no one is telling me, you have to vote for 1, you have to vote for 3, you have to vote for 2. I make that choice based on what's most important to me as a voter. And so I get to walk out of that voting booth having chosen what I wanted to express and gotten to express what I wanted to express. As opposed to now when you walk into the voting booth and you're like, well, I mean, you're not happy no matter what you do. You can either vote for the person you love and know that you've probably helped elect the person you hate, or you can vote for the person you dislike and feel crappy about it and come out and be like, I wish I didn't have to do that, but I guess you got to be practical. Those are lousy choices. And with approval voting, you have the option to say what you want to say. So whether it's whatever that is, you don't get to say, you know, this person's a 1, this person's a 2, this person's a 5, but you can absolutely choose between what is the most important thing for you and to say exactly the thing that is the most important thing for you to say in that moment, in that time.
And you could vote for every candidate who said, I care about the climate, or every candidate who said, I want to put a carbon tax on, or every climate who said, I want the Green New Deal, or you could vote for all the women, or you could vote for everybody except old white men. Yep. I mean, there's a lot of ways you could split it up. So you still do have quite a bit of preference. It's not as much as some people might want.
You get to say what you want to say. You get the flexibility to decide what's important to you, how you're going to split people into those 2
and
groups.
And remembering that you're not the only voter. Everybody else is voting too. So your really strong preference versus a really strong like versus a like probably doesn't matter in the scheme of things. Maybe it matters to you. And I'm going to go back to, I'm going to bring up ranked choice voting, where you get to put people in order. You still don't get to say, I like this one a lot better, but you can get to go 1, 2, 3. You can't put ties, and most of your votes don't even count. Most of what you express on the ballot is never looked at.
Yeah, can we actually talk about ranked choice for a second?
Sure.
Because I think that's the voting method that most people who are interested in reform have heard of, and were most likely to have heard of, RCV, ranked choice voting, or IRV, instant runoff voting. Same thing. It is, so our stand on that is that it's basically, like every voting method, it's better than what we have now. But what I believe about ranked choice is that it's the sort of thing where it appeals to people because you think that it's going to be really great, but there's a lot of problems with it that you don't realize. It's basically not as good as you think it is. One huge disadvantage to me for ranked choice voting is that, and I think you actually experienced, I want to hear your story about the Green Party if there's time. But for me, the problem with ranked choice is that it produces a winner, but it's a black box. Like, it doesn't tell you why that person won. It doesn't tell you how much support that person had, even the winner. And it doesn't tell you how much support anybody else had. The wonderful thing for me about approval voting is at the end of the day, you know, not just who won, but you know why they won. You know how much support they had. This person won with this much percent of the vote. And everybody else on that ballot, you know exactly how much support all of those people had as well. So next election cycle, when I'm considering running for office, I can look back in that and say, well, that person had 30% support, so it wasn't enough to win, but clearly their ideas have some traction. Perhaps I should be considering, you know, taking some of those positions myself because those have some sort of support. And if there's some, on the other hand, if there's a position that has, you know, very little support, you can't blame that on the fact that people couldn't vote for you. Everyone looked at that candidate and said, no. And you have a clear message that is not a position that people like.
Yeah, so you mentioned the time the Green Party, we were using an instant runoff method, and we decided we'd try that, and we had looked at approval voting, and we decided to vote it both ways. No, first we did instant runoff voting, and we were all involved in the counting too, because we wanted to see first step, second step, third step, what happens. So everyone got to put first, second, and third person they liked. And there was a person who was very, very popular, and everybody assumed he was going to win, but everybody made him their second choice.
Second choice.
And then what happened was whoever got first choice with, more first choices than anybody else, which wasn't very many, won, and everybody was upset. Everybody who voted was upset. And we all got to see it because we were going through this as an exercise to see what happens at the first stage. And then if you didn't get voted for first place, you didn't get enough first place votes, you get dropped out, and then the second place vote counts. But he was the one that dropped out because he didn't have any first place votes.
Right. So
didn't count for anybody.
Right. So what ranked choice does is it has a tendency to elect a polarizing winner with a lot of support from one side. Whereas what approval voting is going to tend to do is elect the candidate with the broadest support, the consensus candidate. So exactly like what you're talking about, this is a perfect example of how ranked choice voting fails, is if you have a split, a polarized electorate, and they've each got, you know, it's A and B, and they've each got their candidate that they love and they hate the other one. So A loves A, candidate A, and the B people love candidate B, and they both hate the other one. But there's a candidate C who is everybody's second choice, and both sides are like, yeah, this person's fine. They're my second choice, but I'd be okay with this person. I'd much prefer this person to the other side, but they're not my first choice. I would argue that's the person who should win. And it sounds like this was a situation where you expected that person to win because it was the candidate that most people were okay with. And instead, that person gets knocked out in the first round. And you're left with the same fight between A and B as usual, and you end up with a winner who half the people love and the other half the people hate, instead of a consensus candidate.
Yeah, yeah. And I know there are places that have implemented ranked choice voting and then they didn't like it and they changed. And I think even though I've always thought, well, let's change to something and then we can try for the best one, but that might not be a very good path to take, because once you've changed, it's hard to then look and see, oh, we messed up. Maybe we should go back to the old one. Do you know what I'm saying?
It's also, it's a bit of a detour. It would be much simpler to change from plurality to approval than to change from plurality to RCV and then change from RCV to approval.
Yeah, yeah. So we've gone over my steps pretty much. We've gone over the campaigning, the debates, the actual vote, how you get to state your preference. We've gone over the results, we talked about some of the results, and the analysis at the end, which I think is one of the biggest pluses for approval voting. And you would see how many people who really think climate change was important. Somebody like Jay Inslee, you'd see how much support he really did get.
Even if he didn't win.
Exactly. So let's see. I'm going to throw another one at you.
Great.
We have this pandemic, and it's another case that's got this partisan divide on what we should do about it, apparent partisan divide. And it's also mixed up with some minority who don't think science matters. So how can approval voting handle something like that? Because climate change has had that problem with the climate deniers and people who don't believe the data and don't believe the scientists and listen to a journalist instead. And we have the same thing with somebody talking about wearing masks. Oh no, we don't need to do that. And they don't want to listen to the public health officials or the epidemiologists who have studied it. So how can approval voting somehow help in that kind of a case?
I don't know. I mean, it's really hard to, it's so complicated, you know? I feel like we're in a place in our country where we're really polarized, and we have this tendency to dismiss and demean and attack, to put people on the other side and just dismiss them. And I think that is something that our current voting method instills. It instills this mentality that it's A versus B, as opposed to, because it creates, I mean, to take someone like Trump, he doesn't need to appeal to a broad swath of people to win. He didn't need to appeal to a broad swath of people to win. He had to appeal to his base, and as long as everybody else split the vote, that was enough to get him elected. Under approval voting, that is not going to work. The person that wins is going to be the person that appeals to the most people, the person that reaches, that campaigns everywhere, that talks to everybody, that takes positions that are broadly supported, that doesn't dismiss other people. As far as denying science, I mean, I don't know. I feel like there's this story that's kind of perpetuated in the media about what we believe. I don't really believe. I don't know what to believe about what people really believe. I don't know what people really believe. I suspect that people are a lot more compassionate and reasonable than the narrative would suggest. And I think that narrative is sort of a function of this awful voting system that we have. And if we had a better voting system, we would. The compassion that we feel for each other and the ways that we are united and similar would be rewarded instead of being,
That's actually, I mean, that's really important, because how the discussion and the debate, what happens during that time, is critical for what happens in the election. And if you're rewarding attack instead of getting along and actually searching for what is your difference. I mean, somebody says, I'm for the Green New Deal, and somebody says, I'm not. Well, let's talk about, what do you mean by that? What is it that you're actually against? What is it that you're actually for? Instead of just going, oh, you know, she's for the Green New Deal. Bad, bad, bad. I mean, without having to actually get into the details. And the anti-science, I think, again, it's something that would be helped by more discussion of the actuality behind it, as opposed to just letting it become a partisan divide. And that's the other thing we were going to talk about, was the political landscape, how it's, we think that there's right versus left, or liberal, conservative. And it's a one-dimensional thing. And every issue that comes up has to fit. It's either on the right side or the left side. And I find that so strange. How do issues fall on a one-dimensional line? And can approval voting help us understand that there are other dimensions?
Well, when you only have two choices, you have a one-dimensional scale. The thing that you're voting on is how those two people are different, and they are different on one scale. If you had someone else who was up here, then all of a sudden you've got like a two-dimensional thing. And if you had someone else over here, and someone else over here, and over here, all of a sudden you've got potentially any number of different scales to be measuring people on. And you can, I would argue that that's a better thing, because you're seeing more of the ideas that are out there and more of the things that are worth debating, as opposed to just focusing on what these two people are willing to, you know, when you focus on how they're different, you're losing track of all the ways that they're similar. And there's no one out there, and no one can come in and challenge that under our current system because they would be a spoiler.
That's right. I'm going to throw out that if somebody wants to look at politicalcompass.org, they have a two-dimensional scale. It's right versus left, mostly on the economy, and then libertarian versus authoritarian. And it's interesting, they map common politicians, and you can take a test and see where you fall. And at least it's two-dimensional. That's a step up. Right. It doesn't include things like, is the person a horrible person or immoral? But at least it has more of the issues. Okay, now I'm gonna put you on the spot for Center for Election Science. Approval voting, we both agreed. It's just wonderful and make a big change. Does the Center for Election Science look at other issues about elections like the Electoral College or other things? Are you supporting other changes or this is what you're focusing on right now, approval voting?
I will take a stab at that question, and Caitlin, you can, if you feel like you have a better answer, please jump in. We have decided that focusing on approval voting is the thing that we are doing right now. That is not to say that other voting methods aren't good. It's not to say that we shouldn't do a whole bunch of other host of improvements, reforms. But the thing that we have the momentum for and the skills at and the, if I do say so myself, some incredible successes at is getting approval voting implemented. And I personally think that that is, I can't think of a better thing to be focusing on. I can't think of a solution that is going to be more effective at solving all the problems that we want to solve. So I would say that's what we focus on right now.
Okay, thanks.
Did I get that right, Caitlin?
I think that's an excellent answer, Michael. And it's also important to note, like, our organization is very small. We have 4 staff members. We got our first big, dose of funding just in 2017. And less than a year later, we saw a success in Fargo with them implementing approval voting, the first city in the US to do so, thanks largely to support that we were able to provide to citizens in Fargo to do that. And now we're working in St. Louis to get approval voting implemented there. I think as far as other voting methods go, as Michael stated at the beginning, we think that approval voting essentially is the best bang for your buck, right? It's simple. It doesn't cost anything. It can be used on any current voting machines. It can be used on hand-marked paper ballots. It's easy to count, and it has enormous benefit. So that's why we've chosen to put our resources toward approval voting, especially given the limited number of resources we have, both as far as staff members and funding. And then, of course, there are a host of so many different reforms outside of even voting methods that probably need to be implemented to improve our elections. But there are already a lot of other really great organizations out there doing that work. So the work we're focused on is specifically improving the voting method with approval voting.
Okay, thanks.
And I know that there are some more questions in the chat. Did you have anything else for Michael, Christine?
No, let's go to the questions.
Okay, great. All right, I will go to Steve. You should be unmuted.
Okay, hi.
Hi.
Make some great points here. 2 things occur to me. First, approval voting does favor those candidates and those issues that enjoy broad support, even if they don't enjoy passionate support by a large number. So what that means is CES has a fantastic opportunity to market approval voting by identifying a whole bunch of social issues that have broad support but are not at the top of many people's agendas, like climate, because people who care about climate are going to support approval voting. I think the same is true for voting rights, for causes that are very broad. So it's a great opportunity for this organization. The second point I have has to do with CCL, Citizens Climate Lobby, which Christine, you're so familiar with, and Emily, you are too, and many others. In the world of carbon environmental solutions, I like to think of CCL as everybody's second choice, if not their first. And the reason is this. Everyone agrees we need to make carbon more expensive. But how do you do it? Some people say, we'll put a tax on it, and let's give the money to the military because we need a stronger defense. Other people say, well, let's give the money to fair housing for social justice. Some people say, let's give it to citizens. Now, the people who want to give it to the military definitely don't want it to go to housing. And the people the housing definitely don't want it to go to the military. But pretty much a lot of people think, yeah, let's give it back to citizens in the form of a dividend. Then they can do what they want. So because CCL has that broad appeal, it's a perfect strategy. Approval voting is going to favor that broad appeal solution. And I think if the word got out among the CCL supporters, of which there were over 100,000, which this webinar is intending to do, it would especially favor that. And think about how that would apply to other social issues as well.
Thanks, absolutely.
Oh, you cut him off. He had more.
Michael, and also Caitlin, any thoughts about identifying a wide range of social issues that enjoy broad support and using those as channels to drum up support for approval voting?
That's a good idea. The more people hear about it, the better.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a great solution I feel like it's the solution to everything. It gives us a responsive government that's going to do the things the government should do, whatever that may be, whether it's climate or, justice.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's really interesting that you brought that up, Steve, because that's something that we've been talking about internally. Kirsten, I know that you know Kirsten. She and I have been trying to kind of think of some ideas. And this webinar actually comes out of that idea because we have seen the polling. We know that the broad majority of Americans do back stronger action on and the environment. It's not a left or right issue. Most people agree. And so we thought, hey, we should put together a webinar about approval voting in the environment. So we've been trying to think of some other questions or some other issues there too. And the folks in St. Louis who are currently running a campaign to implement open approval voting primaries, they're doing the same thing in their city. They're identifying the really important issues that are facing citizens in their city, and they're going to have a series of webinars to talk about those issues and how this new election system can help. So you're definitely onto something there, Steve. I also see Marcus has a hand up. You should be unmuted now, Marcus.
Yeah, first I kind of building on what Steve said, better environmental policy is an area in which most Americans want it, but only one political party really wants it. And the same is true for sex ed, as has been mentioned in chat, and also some obvious things like guns. But I've noticed that every single example that I come up with off the top of my head, it's the Democrats who are primarily in favor of it. Can you name any such policies where it's the Republicans who are the main ones in support of it?
I would first challenge your question. You say the Democrats are in support of these things, but do they actually do anything about them?
More than the Republicans.
They talk better than the Republicans, for sure. And sure, yeah, they do better than the Republicans. But I mean, if you had a Green Party candidate there on that scale to compare, how well do the Democrats do on environmental stuff? I just want to challenge that narrative that the Democrats are the ones who are doing everything right and the Republicans are doing it all wrong. I think it's more complicated than that.
Yeah, I can't answer Marcus's question about an issue that Republicans care about that Democrats don't, that has broad support. But I will say, it's surprising how much support. Maybe 2 years ago when I was lobbying in Washington, D.C., and I was assigned to several conservative Republican House of Representatives Congress people, we talked to their aides more than to them, but it was very clear that every single one of them wanted to do something about climate change. But every single one of them wanted to know what the guy down the hall was thinking. because they were so afraid of being the first one and getting knocked out in a primary. So hopefully approval voting can help on that. But it was surprising. And there are a lot, and CCL has a big effort to find the Republicans who care about climate change. And it isn't hard in terms of people, but at the elected representatives, that's where it's hard. But I think it's a good question.
It's a good question. Wonder what the answer is.
Yeah.
Thanks, Marcus. Any other questions? I just put a last call in the chat in case anybody does have any others. So I'll give you just 30 seconds to type anything or to raise your hand if you want to ask anything. Emily's got her hand up again. So let me get her.
I just thought of an answer to Marcus's question about the things that Republicans support that the vast majority of the public supports. And I think that might be things like capitalism or like, just think of like the fringe, what you think of as fringe left ideas. And like anything that's fringe on the left is going to be majority public supports. If you read like Republican news articles, it's like the boogeyman that they talk about are the things that most of the public supports that like the fringe of the left.
So the fringe of the left attacks capitalism. Therefore, capitalism is probably something that most people support. Or the free market.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, I think in the US, I think the vast majority support the free market, which is why socialism has been used as like a bad word for so many years. So if you're looking for things that Republicans support, I would say that kind of thing.
That's a great answer.
I would say that in years past, there were some things in foreign policy that Republicans supported that I think were very popular. But right now we can't, I don't know. Things like not going to war, which Democrats talk about it, but they always start the wars. Things like that. I'm just trying to answer the question, Marcus.
Did you have another comment about that? I just saw you put your hand up.
I had another whole question, actually. I wanted to know how you think the adoption of proportional representation, be it through the Fair Representation Act or sequential proportional approval voting, something like that, what effect do you think that would have on climate policy?
I'll take that, I suppose. I think proportional representation is great. It increases the goal is to sort of prevent the tyranny of the majority and make sure that everybody has a voice in the room. And it's absolutely something that we've talked about. And it is something that is another reform that is sort of separate from approval voting and can easily be implemented alongside approval voting. Approval voting isn't proportional representation. They're not, they're separate, but it is another, I think, another great reform that increases the ability of everybody to have a voice in the room.
All right, there was one final question in the chat from Susan. And I think I need a little bit more clarification from you, Susan, but she just asks, what about vote by mail and getting more people to register? So I'm assuming, Susan, you're asking, do we think that, she says, I think voting for many will be more of a problem this November than usual, and vote by mail is a solution to that. And there are still too many unregistered eligible voters. So are you also asking how getting more people to vote by mail or getting more people to register might help the environmental movement as well, or just in general, just strengthening democracy?
I want to answer that anyway,
yeah.
No matter what the question is. Not the vote by mail part, what can we do about that? I know a lot of people that don't vote because they think their vote doesn't count. Because of this issue of they really have to vote for either one of the top two candidates or not bother voting. And I think that approval voting would really help push registration, because especially young people who think nobody's listening. I mean, it's a big thing to say your vote is going to count no matter who you vote for. It's going to show the true support. I mean, Andrew Yang's people, you know, his actual support would have been shown with approval voting. So that's what I'm thinking. It would really help push registration.
People talk a lot about how bad it is that so few people vote, how little participation there is. And just to point out, in 2016, the two, basically the only two candidates on the ballot, as far as, you know, I mean, you can vote for the Green, but most people don't because they know the Green would be a spoiler, or the Libertarian. The two candidates on the ballot were the least liked presidential candidate ever and the second least liked presidential candidate ever. So imagine those are your choices, and imagine how happy you're going to be to participate in that process, as opposed to imagine if there were a lot of people on the ballot and you got to look at each one and say what you thought about them.
That's a great, great comment. Sorry if you guys can hear the loud noise behind me. But I think that's awesome. We have one more question, I think, from Kanita. So Kanita, I just unmuted you if you want to ask your question, and then I think we'll hop off.
You were asking about an issue that Republicans would support, the pro-life movement, and, you know, that often comes out with the anti-abortion planks. So they would be supporting something like that.
Thanks, Kanita.
You know, you would find that they might, with approval voting, find how many people supported and didn't support that.
And perhaps there's a lot of people that aren't all at one end of the spectrum. Perhaps it's more complicated than that. And there's a lot of people that are in the middle in some ground where everybody, you know, most people are happy.
Yeah, it's another case where that kind of issue shouldn't be owned by either Democrats or Republicans, since it doesn't really fit on one scale compared to other issues.
Yeah, that's a great point. I think that it's tough when we have these issues that require a lot of nuance, right? Our choose one voting method is definitely not set up for nuance at all. Well, thank you guys so much for being here. And thank you, Christine, for hosting and interviewing. And thank you to Michael for answering her questions very eloquently. I think everyone really enjoyed this. I know I did. It was super interesting. For everyone on the call, I really appreciate you all being here too. And thank you so much for supporting our work. As I mentioned, we are currently supporting a campaign in St. Louis, Missouri, to get nonpartisan approval voting primaries with a top two runoff implemented there. So that's kind of our big thing right now, but we also have a chapter program, and we are trying to, foment new campaigns and support grassroots organizers in local communities. And so we have a lot of exciting plans coming up in the next year based on what we're seeing in our chapter program. And in order to do all of these things, in order to have campaigns and reach more people, that requires funding. So if anyone is interested in donating to support our work, we would more than appreciate it. I can stick a link in the chat for you all. But again, we really appreciate you being here, appreciate your support. And thank you so much. Hope everybody has a great day.
Yeah, thanks, Caitlin, and thanks for everybody who watched and listened and talked.
Yay. Thanks, Christine. Thanks, Caitlin.
Thank you all.
All right. Bye-bye.
Bye.